Next, as the Senate debates whether some banks and other financial institutions are too big to fail, NewsHour economics correspondent Paul Solman takes a second look at a company that has some interesting lessons about being small enough to succeed. It's part of his ongoing reporting on making sense of financial news.
When we first visited SRC, the Springfield Remanufacturing Corporation, back in 1990, it was thriving, refurbishing old truck engines.
We tear them down and then we rebuild them.
SRC was an unlikely Rust Belt success story. Given that Japan was supposedly number one in those days, the U.S. dead in the water when it came to manufacturing. The company in Springfield, Missouri, attributed its success to what it called the great game of business. Everyone was on the same team, was taught to read the financials and thus how to keep score.
They want us to know exactly what we're putting out every month.
Finally, the company was owned lock, stock, and crankshaft by its workers, so everyone had a stake in the game's outcome. CEO Jack Stack, who founded SRC.
My people are motivated for one reason. They got an income statement. They all know it. That's their motivation. It's a unifying factor. It's their report card.
So 20 years later, and with China now ascendant, renewing concerns that America may again be consigned to the dust heap of manufacturing history, we wanted to know, how's the company doing? Today's SRC, it turns out, is SRC Holdings, with investments in almost 60 related companies, employing some 1,200 people. Many still remanufacturing cars, tractors, boats, but there's also a home furnishings firm, a warehousing operation, a business that teaches folks how to do business, the SRC way. In an era of too big to fail, SRC's motto would seem to be small enough to succeed.
Most of us came from very, very large factories.
Okay. Jack Stack is still CEO.
It's very, very hard to get passion in the organization over 250, over 400 people. You lose the touch that you really need in terms of building the teamwork that you want.
So every time SRC got near that size, another division was hived off as its own firm, most in Springfield, some beyond. From SRC came SRC Electrical. It makes starters and alternators. A new offshoot from it will soon make electronics. Now, this small is beautiful strategy may not be for everyone, but Stack says it preserves solidarity, flexibility, entrepreneurship, and it has created more opportunities for advancement at SRC.
And once we taught people business and how to understand it and how to be able to run a business, we really prepped them, and so we saw the opportunity of being able to move them into their own businesses to make room for other people to be able to come up through the organization, because it was not only about jobs, it was about opportunities.
Stack's son Tim runs SRC Logistics.
There's a lot of opportunity that we have under this 400,000 square foot building. It's just, where do we start?
This is the so-called Skunk Works, an incubator for new SRC businesses. It collects old parts and devises new uses for them. SRC hopes to turn ideas ginned up here into new companies.
So was that a truck engine?
Yeah, it can be used in trucks. They could put in power units to power houses. They can be put in airboats. We've seen wood chippers.
Of course, not every recycling idea pans out. Auto floor mats, for example.
Well, what exactly were you thinking when you bought thousands of these, it looks like?
We were thinking we could make some pretty good money on it, otherwise we wouldn't have done it. But in reality, they turned out to still be here. But we've been talking to companies about chopping these up into little pieces and using them for playgrounds or turf, where people put fields, artificial turf.
SRC has come to believe that only by keeping its units small and managers empowered can it foster this sort of innovation, which actually saved some of its key companies during the recent crisis in its key industry, automotive.
Automotive got murdered, and our client was General Motors. So we have 200 and some people there that are just virtually out of work.
But this spinoff was small enough to remanufacture itself.
This is our 5.7 liter General Motors engine that we converted for natural gas application.
Natural gas engines became backup electricity units for irrigation, oil drilling. The old engines found new customers, like the U.S. Postal Service. Result, No layoffs during the crisis, and now workers are doing 50-hour weeks, the company hiring again, by following the familiar formula. Learn the financials, share the proceeds, stay small. And that's what it teaches to others like Juliet Mee, who owns this massage training center in Springfield.
I had no idea about how important the numbers were in my business.
Once a math-phobic masseuse, the newly confident Mee has since stabilized the school, even spun off companies to clean linens, hers and others, manage benefits for her staff and those at other small firms.
We'll start with some simple compressions on your back.
The school took a pounding during the downturn, but the fact that the staff was aware of the failing financials, she says, made survival possible.
At the end of last year, our employees knew that some bills had to be paid that the cash was not there for, and they loaned me personally enough money so that I could put that money into the company and pay those bills.
So they gave you this bridge loan when they themselves must have been under financial stress because they want to keep the company going, keep their jobs going, and they trust you.
Because they knew the need was real, and they knew that the cash was not going to come in from any other source.
Not easy for folks who only make about $30,000 a year. With business now in better shape, the topic of a recent staff huddle, whether to take a bonus for the first time in 18 months.
Our income needs to be at $500,000.
Turns out they missed that target by $500. So it went to a staff vote.
No bonus. No bonus. No bonus.
They voted 14-6 against giving themselves bonuses.
We're in this thing together. My employees have kicked it in because they know I'm telling them the truth.
Yeah, I love that.
Megan Chambers was a reluctant open book convert. In 2004, she opened the Springfield clothing boutique Stax. Although the store had great PR and soaring sales, 3 years after opening, she ran out of cash.
All my money was tied in my inventory. It was a difficult time. I was not sleeping at night. I was not eating. This was going to go down, and it was such a good thing. And why was it going to go down? I didn't understand it.
My daughter has style. Okay, if you went to her store, she's got incredible style. But she hates numbers.
Before she married, Megan Chambers was Megan Stack, the only one of Jack's children not playing the game of open book management. The family's dirty little secret since her parents had bankrolled the store.
I bleed open book management. Okay, I believe that you have to have style, but you have to have that financial acumen to order to be able to put the two together.
Finally, I went into a meeting with him, like tears, you know, just like, all right, I'm ready. Like, what do I have to do?
The father would continue to support the store with a $50,000 loan if the daughter opened up her books.
And then she had to sign a commitment with her investor that she would teach everybody financials, and her investor would then audit whether or not everybody understood the numbers.
Obviously, with the variance of our margin and the expenses being a little bit higher than expected.
The Stack staff started talking stats at their monthly meetings. Results? A focus on higher margins and turning inventory faster.
We were successful at it as soon as those books were opened. I mean, it was a growth from that moment, from that month I implemented it, we started to grow.
Just as our interview was wrapping up, an unexpected visitor.
You are not here to terrorize your daughter by making her even more self-conscious.
She does not listen to me.
It is very true in that I definitely could market it and I could sell it and I could do everything else. But when it came to running it in the numbers, it was something I did shy away from.
Not anymore. Now the proprietor envisions a Stack spinoff or two. And maybe even someday, passing SRC's open book management on to the next generation, her new baby daughter, who, with the right help, is also arguably small enough to succeed.